Emrakul of the Promised End is a 13 mana legendary creature Eldrazi, 13/13 with flying, trample and protection from instants. It reads, Emrakul of the Promised End cost 1 less to cast for each card type among cards inside your graveyard. The amount of different card types are 8 and they are the following: lands, creatures, artifacts, enchantments, planeswalker, instants, sorceries, and tribal. If you have all 8 different card types in your graveyard, you will only pay 5 mana for this Cthulhu. The second ability reads the following: when you cast Emrakul, gain control of target opponent during that player's next turn. After that turn, that player takes an extra turn. Welcome to a cEDH gameplay analysis of Emrakul, the Promised End. This is not a deck tech video, this is a video where we focus at analyzing and understanding and talking about how we can build decks with Emrakul inside it. We are gonna be talking about pros and cons, why this is good or why this is terrible. Try to understand the power level of this game plan. Secondly, we're gonna be talking about different commanders that could potentially play this combo. But first, we need to talk about how we're going to achieve this, but also a little bit on what this is actually trying to do. In this format, people are trying to win in various combo ways. For example, Aetherflux Reservoir and a Storm deck. So picture this: you cast Emrakul, the Promised End, when you predict that player is going to win on his upcoming turn. Yeah, that's actually really tricky. And I might actually say this is really difficult. You need a lot of skill in able to predict when an opponent is gonna win with something like this. But if you have some really good knowledge about this format, you might be able to predict it, cast this, control their turn, play their deck, storm off, and put this into play, reach, let's say you have 3 opponents, and you're able to get up to 155 or 160 life with that player's storm run. What you do now is that you pay 100 life to kill the other 2 remaining players that are sitting there and watching. And then you pay 50 life to kill the player that was storming off. That player now has a remaining of 10 life, and he's gonna take 50 damage, so he's gonna go to minus 40. And you're the only player remaining. That's the plan! I've actually been able to do this a few times, and if I can do it, so can you. Accept the challenge. You could almost say that this is something of a bragging challenge. Not the best combo in the world, but if you do it, you're probably pretty good at this game. But let's actually begin with one of the good things about this combo, and one of the reasons why I actually really like it. First, you can reduce the casting cost of this down to something of 7 and 8, or sometimes even 6. When that happens, you have a pretty decent mana cost. But one more thing, this is a 1 card combo, you don't need any packages whatsoever. You put this into play, you pass turn, you take your opponent's turn, and you win with their game plan. You could even use your own counter spells to protect their combo if you have mana for it remainingly. So it basically turns into a 2v1. If you're playing against 3 opponents, you control 1 player, then it's you versus the other 2. So That's pretty amazing and pretty interesting. The second thing about this is that you can't stop it with a counterspell. The part where you steal an opponent's turn is actually a trigger on cast. Therefore, if an opponent actually casts a Force of Will to counterspell Emrakul, you don't get the flying 13/13 with trample and protection from instants, but you still get the trigger to steal the turn. You need something like Nimble Obstructionist. When you cycle Nimble Obstructionist counter target activated or triggered ability. So it's really difficult to interrupt, but I also want to mention that even if you actually don't win the game, you can wreak havoc, and a 13/13 flying with protection from instants isn't that easy to actually get rid of. This is actually pretty big. And if the game progresses and keeps on going and you've wrecked a little bit of havoc, no one is winning, you have a pretty big chance of smirking big face with this thing and your other stuff. So now we've talked a little bit about the positive things about this game plan. We're gonna talk about the negative parts later. First, we should talk about how we're actually gonna reduce the casting cost of this thing. So we're basically gonna build a graveyard deck, filling our graveyard with various card types. But I wanna mention something really important, that whenever you assemble a deck, try to include cards that are gonna be good in general. So, we don't really have a big combo package, we don't have anything special in demand. The only demand we have in construction demand here is that we spread out and have a lot of different variations of cards. Not just only instants and or maybe only creatures, we need to have a little bit of everything, like 10 instants, 10 sorceries, 10 creatures, 10 artifacts, 10 enchantments, etc, etc. So let's begin with looking at some card type examples. But I'm gonna skip lands and instants. Lands, you know, fetch lands, they're gonna end up in your graveyard, that's done. Instants, there are so many good instants in this game. You could easily fill a deck with like 30 instants, and that deck is gonna be amazing. You have Force of Wills, you have Mana Drain, you're done. And easily you can fill your deck with like 10 various counter spells that are gonna be great. I wanna mention Mana Drain, however, that this is actually gonna give you a lot of mana that could help you cast this thing. So I think Mana Drain is pretty powerful and perfect choice of instant for this deck. Now, I actually have three more instants that I would like to showcase for another purpose. We have this, I can't really pronounce it, but until end of turn, target player cannot play instant sorceries or activated abilities requiring an activation cost, and you get to draw a card. You remand the counter-attack spell, return a turn's hand, you get to draw a card. Narset's Reversal. You copy a spell and you send it back to their hand. All of these spells are delaying the game. Your opponents are still gonna be casting their spells that you sent back to their hand, but they're gonna be doing it their next turn. So if an opponent is trying to win this turn, you stop it using some of these spells, and now we have learned what we need to know, so on our coming turn, we cast our big mind-controlling tentacle monster, pass the turn, and control them, and win with whatever they were trying to do that we stopped. Now let's talk about sorceries. In my opinion, the magical count to achieve as many different card types as humanly possible inside your graveyard, you should reach something about 10 cards of that type. So we're gonna need something between 9 to 11 sorceries. And this isn't gonna be that tricky. For example, we have Demonic Tutor, which is gonna find this thing, or something else we really need. We also have Imperial Seal. Or we could also slot in some ramp cards, like Farseek. Restore, return a fetch land from your graveyard back into play and find another land. Or something like Nature's Lore. There's a lot of different ramp sorceries you could include in this deck. There are more sorceries that could develop a game plan further, like Traverse the Ulvenwald, Delerim. If there are four more card types among cards in your graveyard and we are focused at achieving that, you may search your library for a creature card or a land card and put that into your hand. That's great. We also have Fateless Looting, that will also fill our graveyard a tiny bit. Flashbacks, you can fill your graveyard even more. This thing, in my opinion, is pretty much auto included if you're on the color identity of blue. Pay 2 life, draw a card, and put a sorcery into your graveyard, and you get to look at an opponent's hand. And now you get to see if that opponent is very close at winning. And then you know what to do if that opponent is very close at winning. Also, we have this Regrowth. You can return a card that is very good in your graveyard back to your hand. But we also want to have some more interaction. Playing 10 instants isn't really good enough. So here I have a sorcery that I personally really like, fought sees. Only one black mana, you get to look, or actually, you get to reveal the target opponent's hand, and now you get some intel as well, if that player is really close at winning, or if he's a stupid target for your Cthulhu, Emrakul. But you can also remove a card you don't want that opponent to have. The same thing with Inquisition of Kozilek, and the exact same thing, or well, they are weaker versions of it, Duress. And we have some board wipes, and board wipes are in generally good sometimes. Massacre. I don't like paying mana for my spells, and if an opponent controls a plane and I control a swamp, this is a condition not that hard to achieve. We can cast it for free, and all our creatures get -2/-2. We also have this for free mana, Toxic Deluge, and if you want to destroy some artifacts by force, it's a decent and good sorcery, destroying an artifact by X. And if you want to destroy all artifacts, I think this might be the best one. 3 mana to destroy all artifacts. Well, your opponents are gonna gain some life from the converted mana cost of those artifacts, but eh, who cares? We also have this very greedy pox thing, Pierce Whim. You name all of your opponents as foes and yourself as a friend. Each opponent will now sacrifice an artifact or enchantment that is gonna hurt them a tiny bit, and you get to search your library for a land card that will help you cast your big Eldrazi monster. And last but not least, let's look at some more fringe things, because in the end you could be very creative in how you want to construct this. So here we have a Profane Command, 2 black mana and X, choose 2, and the two options I think are the ones that are making this viable is the second and third option. Return target creature card with converted mana cost X or less from your graveyard back to the battlefield. So this is some form of card draw as we are rebuilding creatures back to our board state. The third ability, target creature gets -X/-X until end of turn. So we are killing a creature, we are gaining a creature. It's a decent functional sorcery, a little bit grindy one. Let's proceed with artifacts. And this part should be really easy, considering there's a lot of different mana rocks out there that we could include. Also, we have an artifact here that is also a creature. We have two problems here currently. These cards don't die unless our opponents actually destroy them, which they could do, but it's not guaranteed. Also, the second problem is that this is actually stopping our opponents from winning the game if we want that to happen. Okay, we don't want our opponents to win the game, but we want our opponents to be able to win the game when we are the ones controlling them. So here actually comes another deck construction demand. You don't play lockdown stacks. We're gonna get back to this point later in the video, but you wanna include a whole bunch of artifacts that are self-destructing, like Ursa's Bubble. This is also helping you get some intel on one of your opponents, showing you what they are up to, how close they are at winning, and you put an artifact in your graveyard by you sacrifice this, and you can draw a card later down the road. Mishra's Bubble is the exact same thing. Also, we have an interaction over here. With this, you can exile one card from a graveyard. This is graveyard interaction, and you get to draw a card, drawing more card types and eventually drawing into your big Eldrazi. Also, you have the Nihil Spellbomb, that is a little bit better version, but this is demanding the color identity of black. Also, I actually like Engineered Explosives. If you're playing a 5 or 4 or 3 colors, a high colored deck, then you can tweak this quite well. And this is also going to your graveyard, filling your graveyard with the card type of artifacts. When it comes to enchantments, it's the same thing but a lot trickier, because you're not gonna play that many enchantment mana producing cards. We have Carp the Flowers, and that's great, but we can't really fill our deck with that many mana producing enchantments the same way we can do with mana rocks. Carp the Flowers is a great card in general, you should always play it. Then we have Aedelon of Rehetoric, which is a creature and an enchantment, so it's two card types inside your graveyard, but just like before, this isn't that amazing to include for that typical reason. Instead, let's actually look at the card Cinder Vines. 1 green, 1 red, enchantment. Whenever an opponent casts a non-creature spell, Cinder Vines deals 1 damage to that player. Let's pretend we know, because we have figured it out, that one of our opponent has this combo in their hand. But they're not putting it into play because they can't win with it, because they're gonna die to the Cinder Vines, or you're gonna use this to destroy this. So they're just sitting there with this combo trying to figure out something, and then you cast your big Eldrazi monster, you take their turn, and then when you have their turn, you sacrifice this. Pay one generic mana, sacrifice Cinder Vines, destroy target artifact or enchantment. Cinder Vines deals 2 damage to that permanent's controller. Now, the board state is suddenly open, and this is the difference between Cinder Vines and these two lockdown enchantments. Cinder Vines can self-destruct when we want to open the game, while these two have to sit there. But there's a lot more enchantments that will actually end up inside your graveyard eventually, like this thing. Pair something, something, something. At the beginning of your upkeep, destroy the creature with the least power. It can't be generated if 2 more creatures tied. You choose which one to destroy. So if there are 2 dorks in play, you will choose which dork you want to destroy. When there are no creatures in play, you sacrifice this thing. Here is another card that will also help out versus storm decks. Pretty much similar to Cinder Vines in another various way, but you can also sacrifice this whenever you want to destroy something. Mystic Remora is probably the best example of an enchantment that is eventually ending up inside your graveyard. If you're playing on a budget, From Beyond is actually a bad card, but it's actually helping you tutor for your Eldrazi, Emrakul, the Promised End, and it's helping you gain some tokens that you can use to cast it. I don't recommend this, but if you want to build this deck on a budget, there you go. Here is another grindy, expensive, a little bit more casual enchantment, the Eldest Reborn. It's a saga, and oh, by the way, we're getting new sagas, and if some of the new sagas are coming that's gonna be cEDH viable, then Emrakul would probably grow a little bit if they're in power level. Each opponent sacrifices a creature or planeswalker. Second, each opponent discards a card. Third, put target creature or planeswalker card from a graveyard onto the battlefield under your control, and then this will go to your graveyard. Creatures. Now this part could also be really easy, just fill your decks with dorks, but we are on a self-destructing team, so what I actually think is gonna be quite good is something like Sakura Tribe Elder. You can sacrifice this to find a basic land. You can cycle this. This will now go to your graveyard. You will search your library for a basic land, and you get to draw a card for 3 mana instant speed. There's an upgraded version, 4 mana, but you get the basic land into play. We also have some interaction. Nimble Obstructionist. You can cycle this to counter an triggered or activated ability. Sometimes that's huge. And you get to draw a card. You can't use counter spells to stop this, by the way. We also have some sorcery speed. Don't know if that's actually good though, but for 2 mana you get to destroy target. Is it non-black or non-artifact creature? Kinda. We also have this thing, Fairy Machabre. You can discard this, you don't need to pay any mana, you don't need to do anything else, you can do it at instant speed, and you can exile up to 2 cards from graveyards, and this fairy will go to your graveyard. We also have this thing, and now we're suddenly actually self-destructing. For 1 mana, choose 1. Goblin Crater Maker deals 2 damage to target creature, or destroy target colorless non-land permanent. We are now on the card type Planeswalkers, and this is where something huge has happened. Wizards of the Coast has actually printed a few really good Planeswalkers that is actually increasing the possibility of having Planeswalkers inside your deck. And here are 2 Planeswalkers that are actually showing up inside various cEDH decks just because the cards are actually good. And that was one of the demands I had, that we want to include as many good cards as humanly possible. We shouldn't include 10 Planeswalkers just because we want to include as many card types as humanly possible. Don't include Planeswalkers that aren't gonna be good. And here are some examples of Planeswalkers that I actually view good enough. I could pretty much play these walkers in any deck. There are some few more walkers that you could actually look at, but Ashiok the Dream Render, Narset Potter of Veils, 3 mana steal an artifact, 3 mana bounce a card, and you can make sure your opponents can't cast spells during your turn. I actually think these cards are good in general. But if we actually get more walkers in the future, then suddenly we are getting somewhere. Let me even give you an example of a walker that almost makes the cut. It's the 4 mana that is a bit of the problem. Garruk Relentless. He can't actually buff. He has 3 loyalty counters. He has 2 0 activations. You get a wolf. That is cute. But the second one that is actually good. He will fight something. And if he survives, he will flip to this. And it's the flip that is also making it a little bit slow. Because you can't activate it the moment he flips. You have to pass turn and hope he survives on only 2 loyalty. And I have to say, that hasn't always proven to be that good. But he has a really good ability. So, -1, sacrifice a creature. If you do, search your library for a creature card, reveal it, put it into your hand, then shuffle your library. You can simply sacrifice a dork, and maybe he will die. Now, you will have a dork, and you will have this walker in your graveyard, and you will have Emrakul in your hand. So, he is doing something we want to happen. But the card on its own, in my opinion, just isn't good enough. I have actually playtested this game plan with Garruk, and I wasn't satisfied with the result. Moving forward, we have Tribal, and I don't really think Tribal is good at all. I don't think we should include any cards just because they are Tribal, and they're gonna help us with our Emrakul game plan, because the cards are just bad compared to other cards that aren't tribal. For example, this is tribal instant, that means you have both instant and tribal, but it's 3 mana for something that should cost 2 mana. Now we've reached the part where we're gonna talk about the negative parts about this game plan, because there are some really important negative parts you need to think about trying to go for this game plan and this combo. In my world, there's only one big major thing, that it's slow and actually takes some time to assemble. We don't need any specific, we just need to fill our graveyard with various card types and we need to get this in our hand. But we also need to figure out if our opponents are gonna win, so we might sit there with this on our hand, waiting for the perfect timing. We are basically playing some form of control deck, making sure our opponents are unable to win until we want them to win, and then we time this perfectly and steal it from them. Another semi-problem is that some combos doesn't do infinite damage, or you can't control them to win the game for you. They are basically attacking with infinite tokens, or they are winning with Laboratory Maniac or Jace, Wielder of Mysteries. And in those cases, you can't steal the win, you can only give away the win. And we don't want that to happen. In worst case scenario, if an opponent is trying to deck himself with, let's say, Laboratory Maniac, you could basically deck that player without the Laboratory Maniac. So you're killing one player, but you haven't really done much with the two remaining players. You could steal the player's turn, gain infinite mana, do as much problem towards the other two opponents as humanly possible, and then deck that player, kill that player that you're currently controlling. Now you've gotten rid of that, you've weakened your other two players, and then you're trying to kill your opponents with this flying 13-13. So that's also a weakness, I would say, that it's not really guaranteed win, it's very fringe and it's very strange, and I have to say, it's actually really difficult. Let's move on, let's look at commanders I've actually played this combo with, or other potential commanders that could perform this. I have played this with Najeela, and the main reason I did it with Najeela was because of Tainted Pact, and that she's a 5-colored commander that could easily fill all various really good enchantments and artifacts and other cards that I thought I would need to achieve this. But Najeela wins through one card combos without any form of combo package, but I could also use Tainted Pact to find Emrakul, because I don't care about all the cards I'd exile getting my hands on Emrakul with my Tainted Pact. Decklist in the description below of the video. Also, I've played this combo with these two commanders. Not the Opius Thief, but let me just put it like this. These two commanders are in generally really good, and they give you four color identities. That means that you can assemble a really good deck containing a lot of the cards that we've been looking at to achieve the as many card types as humanly possible inside your graveyard. I've also played Emrakul the Promised End inside my Yuriku Tiger's Shadow, and so have probably a lot of other Yuriku players out there, because Yuriku wanna have this super expensive card inside her deck. She doesn't wanna have it inside her hand, she wanna cast a Brainstorm or use Scroll Rack to put it back on top of your library to deal some amazing, insane burn damage with a Ninja Commander. Decklist in the description below of the video. A commander I think could actually perform this deck quite well is Muldrotta the Grave Tide. They have one thing in common. Muldrotta enjoys different card types, and Emrakul also enjoys different card types. And in Muldrotta's case, you could cast Emrakul from your graveyard, so you could build a deck that is just putting cards into your graveyard throughout the game to eventually just have Emrakul to a CMC of 6 mana, or maybe even 5 if you include some not that good tribal cards. And then you could sit there and just sacrifice Emrakul, recast Emrakul, and have a really annoying and powerful Muldrotta, grindy, controlly, weird, typical Muldrotta deck. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope you enjoyed the video. If you like what I do and you wanna support me, consider sharing my videos or even checking out my Patreon page. Also, purchasing cards from the TCG Players website using the affiliate link down below will also help the channel grow. So a big thank you to all of you.